Geneviève Guilbault.
Geneviève Guilbault, deputy premier of Québec. So you're number two in François Legault's Québec government, and you're minister of transport as well. First of all, my question is for you as Minister of Transport. You live in Quebec City, but we're recording this interview in Montreal, which is known for its roadworks, its roadblocks, its traffic problems. At present, there are 51 roadwork sites in metropolitan Montreal, and 21 come under the responsibility of the Ministry of Transport. Was it hard for you to get to this hotel today, where we're doing the interview? There are some roadworks, obviously. I drove up Highway 20 today. It depends on whether you take the 20 or 40, as the problems are different. But yes, this summer we do have 51 roadwork sites. They're coordinated, and they're not all my ministry's projects. Some are by the City of Montreal. Actually, we did a lot of whittling to come down to 51. There are a lot of things to fix, our roads and bridges and tunnels and viaducts were more or less all built at the same time, so they're reaching the same stage at the same time. And I happen to be Minister of Transport when they all need fixing. We're getting it done. You said it took better coordination. You're satisfied with the way things are coordinated. When you were elected in the riding of Louis Hébert, that was during a by-election in 2017, Premier François Legault called you the new star of politics. So help us learn more about you, get to know you better. You were born on Montreal's South Shore in Greenfield Park. Your family moved to Quebec City when you were small. What was your family like? What were the family values at home? I'd say a pretty ordinary family. That's not meant to be pejorative, an ordinary family in the sense that we had two good parents. They had two children, my brother and me, and then later on a second brother. We moved to Quebec City when I was quite small. My father worked in the private sector for a while and then spent a lot of time in government. My mother is a nurse. You studied in Quebec City at Université Laval in public relations. Then you did a master's in institutional and organizational communications. What drew you to that field? I think I've always been interested in communication. It's odd. One of my master's directors at the time, when I was doing a lot of projects on government communications, said to me, you know, it's really unusual to find students interested in subjects like government communications, government communication plans, institutional strategies. And he thought it was quite funny. And I said, well, I'm interested in all of that. And I started working in that field. You were talking about my family. My father has always talked a lot about politics. He was always interested in politics at all levels, municipal, provincial, and federal. We always went to the polls when we were young, and every time there was an election campaign, we'd hear a lot about it. It didn't always make sense to us. You know, you'd hear names here and there. You'd hear the name Jacques Parizeau, Lucien Bouchard. I was 12 when the 95 referendum took place. I heard a lot about it. My parents were separated, and one of them was a yes supporter, and the other one was in the no camp. So it left a mark. My extended family was very representative of the results of the referendum vote, actually. So at the time, you don't really know what kind of influence it'll have, but you grow up with all these names in your head and it leaves a mark. I always went to the polls. I would help my mother or my father. Sometimes I would draw the X for them, and I think it all left a mark. It really shaped who I ended up becoming. So politics was very much a part of your life. There was a lot of debate, there was a lot of discussion, and sometimes probably were a bit stubborn too. A lot of complaining sometimes, you know, complaining was typical. We'd be having our soup and somebody would be complaining or railing against one decision or another. As I started growing up, and started paying taxes and became aware that I was funding certain systems and I had children. And then, you know, I thought rather than just being dissatisfied with things, I should try to do something myself. But I do think a lot of what I heard growing up had a role to play in that. So rather than complaining, you wanted to get involved, right? You were director of communications at the Quebec coroner's office. That's when you became known, really, because you had a number of crises. You were in charge of communications when the Lac Mégantic rail tragedy happened. There were 47 deaths during the Île Verte fire, and then 32 deaths among seniors, six dead when there was a shooting at the Quebec mosque. You always did seem very much in control, but were there any moments during this crisis management that you found particularly difficult? Yes, those were three major crises in Quebec's history, but there have been many others. I want to come back to what's happening with staff in long-term care homes. As you know, for a number of days, we have been receiving reinforcements and support. After the premier called for help, we're continuing to get support, and today we'll be receiving some 400 soldiers, 400 armed forces who will be coming to Quebec. During the pandemic, I think people also became very aware of domestic violence. A lot of women were hurt and killed. So that's when I started becoming involved in that. It went beyond killings. There was violence against women in general. I spoke to a lot of women, heard a lot of stories. Given the urgency and seriousness of the situation, I am today announcing a plan and a firm commitment by our government. And it is this: over the next 5 years, we will be investing some $223 million in additional funding to prevent domestic violence and the killing of women. I'm deeply touched by these tragedies, and that is why I'm so committed to my work, so committed to what I need to do. Because, you know, behind the public speaking, behind the communications work and the interviews, there's a lot of work going on with the bereaved victims of violence, with groups helping these people. This is a very human and anonymous aspect to the work meetings we have to understand how things are working out and do what needs to be done. And in all these circumstances, you know, the example I give is Lac Mégantic. This is 2023. In July, it'll be the 10th anniversary of the Lac Mégantic tragedy. 47 people died, but many, many survivors and families, brothers, children who were very young at the time, who are now teenagers or preteens, and we talked to them. We needed a lot of information. We needed DNA. We needed to identify people. And I remember, you know, at the time when somebody would talk to me after an interview or a press briefing and thank me, I couldn't believe they were thanking me because I was just sharing information. I wasn't directly affected. They were. They were. I was so deeply touched that they were resilient enough to, in that suffering, find it in themselves to thank me. I was just overwhelmed, and I left absolutely struck by this, and that's when I really understood the importance of public service. So you made the jump into politics in 2017. Your parents, you said, talked about politics a lot. It was very much present in your home. Then at the coroner's office, you had a desire to become engaged. But what made you decide to run in the Louis Hébert by-election? You were pregnant at the time. I'd been thinking about it for a while. I'd worked in political offices for 2 years after finishing my bachelor's degree. Then I did other things. And that's when I realized I didn't necessarily want to work in somebody else's political office, but to actively be engaged in politics myself. I wanted to run for office, and I decided, okay, I'm going to make it happen. I picked the CAQ because the CAQ had been founded in 2011, and it was best aligned to my values and to what I wanted to do. So I approached them. You approached them. Yes, that's right. I didn't really know where to start. I found someone to whom I could send my resume, and I said I'd be interested. In the meantime, I'd become a member of the party. I was campaigning in my home riding of Louis Hébert. I said I'd be interested in becoming a candidate at some point. There was a general election coming up in 2018. I met some people. And, you know, a series of events led to a vacancy in Louis Hébert. People didn't think that it was possible for the CAQ to swing that riding. Louis Hébert had been a liberal stronghold for a long time. And the incumbent was Sam Ahmed. He'd been very, very popular, but I managed to win the riding. And quite a victory, 51% of the vote. Well, we did that against all odds. Really, very big paradigm shift for that riding. So we won in 2018, won the riding again in 2022. But that's not how things were when I started canvassing to become a candidate in 2016. After 2018, when the CAQ was elected in Quebec, Premier François Legault appointed you to public safety. Then there was a pandemic that very quickly broke out, and that was really the event underpinning your first term. In 2018, you were appointed Deputy Premier. So you were Deputy Premier and Minister of Public Safety, really on the front row of crisis management, and this was unprecedented. Quebec hadn't seen a pandemic for 100 years. So day after day, you were with Premier Legault as he gave his daily press briefings, and you really became the face of government during the pandemic. What do you remember about that? What was your greatest challenge during that whole experience? Well, I'd say it was a twofold challenge. As Deputy Premier, my duty was simply to replace the Premier. When the pandemic first took hold, it started in China and Eastern countries, and then it moved to the West, and it really hit hard. We declared a state of emergency on March 13th, 2020. I'd given birth on January 4th. I was home with a baby, watching on the news. And when I came back sometime later, the state of emergency was declared not long after. We had a worldwide pandemic. And we decided that every day the Premier would notify the public of what was happening. So Mr. Legault became the head of the daily news delivery. But at some point, he really had to take a day off. He couldn't do that the whole year. So it was clear that at some point I'd have to replace him. But, you know, when it actually happens, there's so much pressure. And people are so used to their daily briefing. And François Legault's credibility was so high that you really, really have to get it right. Remember, we are doing exactly what we need to do right now, and we will get to our goal. Well, the first time I replaced him was Saturday. I'm usually pretty good at managing stress because I have a lot of complex things to do, and I generally hope to get them right. But that time, that first time, I was really stressed. Over time, as Minister of Public Safety, I was responsible for many of the measures we had to put in place, and that was difficult. At one point, we needed roadblocks because we had to prevent people from traveling between one region and another. Then there was a curfew. And the curfew, I think, was the most difficult and controversial. Yes, and controversial measure to put in place. It cost the most politically. And honestly, from on a... It was the oddest, because we're in a free and democratic society, and we had to put in place a curfew, but our schools stayed open, our daycare stayed open. It was a kind of scheduled risk management. We put the curfew back on December 31st. There was an alert on cell phones. The second time, the second curfew was worse than the first. Because, you know, I still hear about it sometimes, not much, but sometimes. It's the second curfew that really people objected to. Because a lot of things would make sense, like not too many social contacts and things like that. People would hear the same thing every wave. But getting a text message, a text alert on New Year's Eve, December 31st, that all combined to make the curfew really much less easy to digest. The Premier appointed you Minister of Transport in October 2022, but you remained Deputy Premier. And you had to explain why the government was walking back on its promise of building a third link. It had been promised in 2018. It had been promised again in 2022. And the government changed its mind about 6 weeks after elections. Last Thursday announced a change to our Quebec-Lévis tunnel project. So there again, you had to explain this to the public. How did it feel? Good. I'd say in all the press conferences I've done, this wasn't the most enjoyable thing I've ever done. But, I'm clear with my conscience. I didn't know if we'd be in government again. I didn't know if I'd have a ministerial portfolio. That's a premier's decision. But I did say that I'd be interested in transport. So I got it, and I was in the national capital, so I knew that even if I hadn't been Minister of Transport, I would still have been elected where I was. There's a whole communications challenge. The communications had been rather vague. The studies and the whole issue of studies that we'd been waiting for were difficult to absorb, particularly for my colleagues from the national capital and Chaudière-Appalaches. But it was a promise. Very much a part of the CAQ program, and backtracking like that was really tough. The people of Quebec City said they'd been cheated by your government. Some commentators even said that your government had been arrogant and taken Quebecers for fools. How do you respond to that? You know, I can't blame people for being disappointed or angry, but to think that I would have spent 36 days campaigning and talking to my constituents every day and telling them we were going to go ahead with a project knowing we weren't, well, that's really not me at all. In fact, I'm, if anything, too direct, too frank, too transparent. I would never knowingly lie to voters, never, never. But in spite of everything, your government is still dominating the polls. Yes, there's periodic drops in Quebec City. But poll after poll, the CAQ is at the top and doesn't even seem worried by the opposition parties, which are pretty divided, it must be said, in the National Assembly. How do you explain your government's continued dominance in the polls? Well, the National Assembly has four parties now. We had only two for quite a long time. Then we had a third, and now we have four. But we've got a very good premier. He's my party leader. But it goes beyond that. I think during the pandemic, people discovered that their leader was even better than they suspected. There's also something else. Pride, nationalism, and the economy have always been very important subjects to Quebecers. And since 2018, this whole nationalism aspect, a renewed pride in identity, I'm seeing that. And what we've done about secularism, what we're doing about French, might have helped revitalize something that is very deep within Quebecers. We're saying, you know, this is Quebec. We are in our home. We are proud. We don't need to be uncomfortable about defending our values, our culture, and our language. So we have a government that's supporting this desire for us that we have to assert ourselves, and it moves things forward and says, we are proud. We're the only French-speaking nation in the English-speaking, in a vast English-speaking North America. How do you see Quebec 10 years from now? I see Quebec as being modern, and I use that word a lot. We need to see ourselves and be modern economically and in other areas. I talked about the premier and the issue of nationalism, but the economy is directly related to that, because I don't think we can have Quebec evolve or even last in government without economic credibility and the ability to stimulate economic growth in Quebec, which we're doing now. I'm proud of that. In transport, we're doing everything we can to modernize, diversify, and electrify our economy. Transport in generally, and this positions Quebec very well, not only in North America, but globally. It positions Quebec to reach zero emissions by 2050, zero, or to be carbon neutral by 2050. This is a goal that many countries share, but what's going to make the difference between countries that get there is how. We are in a very good position, and we are attracting competition. We have a head start because of hydroelectricity. François Legault's vision is becoming reality, and in 10, 20, and 30 years, Quebec will stand out economically once again, but in a way that will enable us to keep up with the times, with the whole issue of climate change, adaptation, greening, renewables, everything. What we're doing now is really going to pay off in 10 and 20 years' time. Speaking about the future, what's your future? What are your political ambitions? A Léger poll puts you as the most likely successor to François Legault. 41% of Quebecers see you as premier one day. So what's your response to that? How does it feel? Well, you know, polls are polls. I've been in politics for 6 years. There are always polls. Then you have to look at the way the poll was constructed, because sometimes there are goals subtending the poll. But regardless, of course, it's always flattering to do well in a poll. But one day, Mr. Legault will leave. And if he were to leave, would you be interested in running for leadership of the CAQ? Frankly, my approach is that the boss is the boss, the leader of my party is here to stay. So I'm not going to do anything with that. I have a lot of work to do now. I have a lot of things to learn now. And actually, the person who's teaching me the most about politics is François Legault. I absolutely adore François Legault. I know he's not perfect, but what he has accomplished, founding a party and then bringing it to a majority government 7 years later and making it one of the most popular governments in history, that is a remarkable achievement. You are a very confident person, a very confident woman. What advice would you give to a young woman who might be thinking of going into politics? I would say, go for it. Go for it, because there are not enough of you there. And the more women there are in politics, the less inaccessible politics will seem. You know, there's always a good reason not to do something, and then you just stay in your comfort zone. But if you feel the desire to go into politics and engage, it looks like a difficult challenge, too. The other thing that's important is not to end up with regrets. So I would say go for it. And yes, it is difficult because women are not treated the same as men. I don't think it's done consciously or deliberately or maliciously. It's just been that way for so long, but things are changing. We will end up with parity. We will end up with 50% of women as elected representatives, more women in key positions, decision-making positions. I think a woman who is sure of herself, who has authority, who can be firm, who can sometimes be a bit impatient. Well, you know, traits that are traditionally associated with any person in a position of importance with responsibilities. But the perception of that woman is different than if she were a man. It's often said that politics just takes over your life. How do you reconcile politics and family? Oh, it's difficult. I've been a politician when I had both my children, but my children were born into it, so they've never known me as anything other than a politician. They think that's how things are. But yes, I do see them less. We've evolved over the last few years, and I welcome what I hear about reconciling work and family. We talk a lot about it, theoretically, but, you know, in practice, it can be difficult. In real life, reconciling work and family means what? Having your children looked after, because you do have to work. I can't stop checking my emails at 5 p.m. and start again at 8:30 in the morning. My kids won't be 5 again, or 6 again, or 7 again. They're 3 and 5 now, and those times won't come back. But sometimes, you know, I tell the team, I've got my kids, I'm not going to answer the phone. And people understand. So yes, it's difficult, but, you know, you'd say it's worth it. Well, now, it is, yes. At the beginning of this interview, we were talking about, like, mégantique, the crises, the value of public service, and that really is what drives me. When I meet people, when the parliamentary session ends and we go back to our ridings and I'm out of the parliamentary bubble, I go out, go to restaurants, and people come talk to me. Women come talk to me and they say how much they like to see women in positions of authority like this, not just in politics, but everywhere. We need female role models, not just me, many. We need female role models who can hold their own in formerly male-dominated environments. And that is very important to me. And that is what I tell my 5-year-old daughter, who thinks I'm always working and always on the phone. And I tell her, you know, maybe when you're as old as mommy, you'll do the same job that mommy does. And it might be easier for you to do mommy's job because mommy did it first and did some groundbreaking. I'll explain things differently when she's older. Geneviève Guilbault, Deputy Premier of Quebec and Minister of Transport. Thank you. Thank you.